बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। दिस वीडियो इज़ अबाउट एट्रोफिक राइनाइटिस, आल्सो कॉल्ड ओजीना। एट्रोफिक राइनाइटिस इज़ अ टाइप ऑफ क्रॉनिक राइनाइटिस। क्रॉनिक इज़ अ कंडीशन विच इज़ ऑफ मोर देन 12 वीक्स और 3 मंथ्स इन ड्यूरेशन। एट्रोफी मीन्स लॉस और वेस्टेज ऑफ टिश्यू, एंड राइनाइटिस मीन्स इन्फ्लेमेशन ऑफ द नेजल म्यूकोसा। So basically, atrophic rhinitis is chronic inflammation of the nose characterized by atrophy of nasal mucosa and turbinate bones, and the nasal cavities becomes roomier and filled with the foul smelling crusts. There are two types of atrophic rhinitis: primary atrophic rhinitis and secondary atrophic rhinitis. Let's talk about the primary atrophic rhinitis in detail. The exact etiology behind primary atrophic rhinitis is not known. However, various factors are involved in causation, and for remembering these factors, we have a mnemonic called hernia. In the word hernia, H is for hereditary factors, E is for endocrinal disturbance, R is for racial factors, N is for nutritional deficiency, I for infection, and A for autoimmune process. Hereditary factors are involved in the causation of atrophic rhinitis, as the disease is known to involve more than one member in the same family. Then the endocrinal disturbances also play a role. As the disease starts at puberty, it is more common in females and it ceases after menopause. Racial factors are also involved, as the primary atrophic rhinitis is more common in yellow and white races. Nutritional deficiency also play a role in causing primary atrophic rhinitis, like the deficiency of vitamin A, D, iron, and some other dietary factors. Then various organisms are cultured from the cases of atrophic rhinitis, such as Klebsiella oozani, which is the main causative organism, and other bacteria like diphtheroids, Proteus vulgaris, E. coli, staphylococci, and streptococci, but they are all considered to be secondary invaders responsible for foul smell rather than the primary causative organisms for the disease. And they are all proteolytic bacteria. Then the autoimmune process. The body reacts by a destructive process to the antigens released from the nasal mucosa. Viral infection or some other unspecified agents may trigger antigenicity of the nasal mucosa. Let's talk about the pathology involved in primary atrophic rhinitis. Basically, the ciliated columnar epithelium of the nasal mucosa is replaced by squamous epithelium. So there is squamous metaplasia of ciliated columnar epithelium. Then there is atrophy of seromucinous glands, venous blood sinusoids, and nerve elements. Arteries show obliterative and arthritis, in which there is severe proliferation of inner lining of an artery that results in occlusion of the lumen of the artery. Bones show reabsorption, so there is widening of nasal chambers, and paranasal sinuses are small due to their arrested development. The patient of primary atrophic rhinitis will present with the following symptoms: foul smell from the nose, making the patient a social outcast, but the patient himself is unaware of the smell due to the merciful anosmia, which is due to the degeneration of the nerve elements. Then there is a nasal obstruction, and large crusts are formed in the nose, and when these crusts are removed, there is epistaxis or nosebleed. Anterior rhinoscopy will show the following signs: greenish or grayish black dry crusts in the nasal cavity, and after the crusts are removed, nasal cavities appear roomier, and these crusts called bleeding. Nasal mucosa appears pale. Septal perforation and nasal vestibulitis may be seen. Nose may show a saddle nose deformity due to the atrophy of the underlying structures. Atrophic changes may be seen in the pharyngeal mucosa, which may appear dry and glazed with crusts called atrophic pharyngitis. Similar changes may be seen in the larynx with cough and hoarseness of voice called atrophic pharyngitis, and hearing impairment may occur due to the obstruction of Eustachian tube and middle ear effusion. Then the disease is diagnosed clinically depending on the signs and symptoms, and no special investigations are needed. Let's discuss an exam question related to this condition. A 20 years old female presents with the complaints of loss of smell, nasal blockage and intermittent mild epistaxis on cleaning the nose. On examination, there was greenish crusting in both nostrils with extremely foul smell. What is the diagnosis and how will you treat the patient? I hope by now, by the signs and symptoms of this patient, you will be able to diagnose the condition that it is primary atrophic rhinitis. And let's talk about its treatment options. You can give the medical or surgical treatment. In medical treatment, basically we have to maintain the nasal hygiene, which can be done with the help of nasal irrigation and removal of crust. For removal of crust, warm normal saline or alkaline solution made by dissolving a teaspoonful of powder containing soda bicarbonate 1 part, sodium biborate 1 part, sodium chloride 2 parts into 80 ml of water is used to irrigate the nasal cavities. The solution is run through one nostril and comes out from the other, and it loosens the crust and removes thickened nasal discharge. Hard crust may be difficult to remove by irrigation, and they are first loosened and then mechanically removed with forceps or suction. Then the second thing is 25% glucose in glycerin. It inhibits the growth of proteolytic organisms which are responsible for the foul smelling. Then antibiotics are given after the nasal irrigation, in which camecetin, which is an anti-ozonal solution containing chloromycetin, estradiol and vitamin D3, and it may be found useful in treating the underlying infections. Then estradiol spray helps to increase the vascularity of nasal mucosa and regeneration of seromucinous glands. Placental extract injected submucosally in the nose may provide some relief. Systemic use of streptomycin 1 gram per day for 10 days has given good results in reducing crusting and odor, and it is effective against Klebsiella organisms. Potassium iodide given by the mouth promotes and liquefies nasal secretions. After the medical treatment, we also have surgical treatment options available, which include Young's operation, in which both the nostrils are closed completely just within the nasal vestibule by raising flaps. Then they are opened after 6 months or later, and in these cases, mucosa may revert to the normal and crusting is reduced. And nowadays we have modified Young's operation, which is used to avoid the discomfort of bilateral nasal obstruction. And it aims to partially close the nostril, and it is also claimed to give the same benefit as the Young's operation. So these surgical options are also used in primary atrophic rhinitis. Then the surgical procedures which aim to narrow the nasal cavities can also be used, as narrowing the nasal cavities also help to relieve the symptoms, and these procedures include submucosal injection of Teflon paste, section and medial displacement of lateral wall of the nose, insertion of fat, cartilage, bone or Teflon strips under the mucoperiosteum of the floor and the lateral wall of the nose and mucoperichondrium of the septum. Let's talk about the secondary atrophic rhinitis. Secondary atrophic rhinitis may be due to any underlying infection, like septic infections like syphilis, lupus, leprosy, rhinosecleroma. They may lead to the atrophic changes. Atrophic changes may also occur in long-standing cases of purulent sinusitis, radiotherapy to the nose, or excessive surgical removal of turbinates. So So that's all about atrophic rhinitis. I hope you enjoyed the video. Hit the like button, subscribe to the channel for more updates. Leave a comment below for any suggestions or if you find any problem, because I read all the comments. And thanks for watching.